Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Zion Rising by Matthew P. Gilbert, narrated by Gary Bennett. In a separate light cone, the walls close in. Aboard the heavy cruiser Dresden, Admiral Susan Vanoff buckled into her command chair and clenched her jaw as she watched the battleboard tallies rise and fall. The actual conflict was far too distant to observe with the naked eye, but the computers tracked the ships and displayed symbols and status projected onto the main transteel viewport as more of her ever-dwindling fleet shattered under enemy fire. The planet Zion, visible through the transteel, hung below the Dresden, blue against the black of space, defenseless. Above and ahead, the twisting nether of hyperspace spilled through into the real, disgorging waves of enemy ships. Somewhere on the other side of the bleeding rent in space, an enemy vessel was holding the jump gate open, allowing its allies to flood through. Lieutenant Smith, Vanov's weapons officer, called out, "We have an ID on the projecting ship. It's a research vessel named the Sagan." "Take it out," Vanov ordered. Smith worked his controls, frowning. "We're having trouble getting a lock on it, Admiral. It's holding on the edge of the overlap, and we're getting scatter from our sensors." "Very well. Miss Shorey, move us into a more direct position for firing," Vanov ordered. Lieutenant Shorey, a slight Asian woman, snapped a salute and spun in her chair to follow her orders.
"Aye, ma'am. ETA 2 minutes."
"Very well," Vanov answered. "Mr. Al-Jahar, inform the fleet that we are moving to engage the Sagan. Our escorts will move with us, and the rest will maintain the line at all costs."
Ensign Al-Jahar gave her a curt nod and turned to his task.
"Aye, Admiral."
A dotted green line appeared on the battleboard, showing the cruiser's intended destination and current position. Enemy vessels, marked with red dots, continued to spill from the open jump gate. Each immediately turned toward the Dresden and opened fire. Fortunately, they were all small vessels, not built for war. Her shields would hold, as long as none of the attackers managed to get close enough to actually ram her. Steady streams of plasma boiled across the gap between them, accompanied by the metallic thuds of railguns as the Dresden defended herself. The battle would doubtless go Vanov's way. Her ships outnumbered the pestilence-infected vessels, and the enemy was awkward using human ships. But the incursions were coming more often now. Each breach whittled away at her forces, costing her precious, irreplaceable ships and men, while the pestilence seemed to have an inexhaustible supply of fodder. How could these security breaches continue to happen? Once was happenstance, twice coincidence, three times was enemy action. Lieutenant Smith interrupted her dark musing to announce,
"Admiral, I have a firing solution on the Sagan."
"Very well. Target the Sagan with all 10 torpedo tubes. Adjust your time on target to stagger warheads at 10-second intervals. Maintain screening fire with primary weapons."
As Smith entered the data into his console, Vanov turned to her helmsman.
"Miss Shorey, as soon as the torpedoes are away, standard speed back to the line. Mr. Al-Jahar, have our escorts retreat beyond the blast radius and cover our withdrawal."
All three officers called,
"Aye, Admiral,"
and set to their tasks. Vanov watched the Dresden's tracking line on the battleboard shift at an acute angle as Shorey laid in her course. Smith called,
"Torpedoes ready, Admiral."
"Fire!"
Smith issued commands through his console, and the Dresden shook with the launches.
"Torpedoes away!"
Shorey, focused on her own console, called,
"Coming about."
The heavy cruiser lurched and thrummed about them as Shorey set her into a wide arc and pushed the engines to maximum power. Vanov watched the battleboard intently for incoming enemies.
"Mr. Al-Jahar, aft display, please."
Al-Jahar worked his console, and a new display sprung up on the primary view screen. The Dresden's actual rear was a half mile behind the bridge, its viewpoint obstructed by the superstructure. Even so, the image definition was high enough that it was indistinguishable from the real thing. 10 torpedo trails streaked away into the star-strewn void, each on a slightly different trajectory, headed toward the twisting red and black of the jump gate. Within the vortex, barely visible, loomed the large and roughly spherical shadow of the science vessel Sagan. Vanov forced herself to relax her grip on the arms of her command chair. It was useless and showed her nerves to the crew.
"Mr. Smith, time to first impact."
15 seconds, ma'am."
As she expected, multiple enemy ships began crossing over. Three dark shadows slowly resolved as they transitioned into real space, interposing themselves between the Sagan and the incoming torpedoes. A garbage scow, what looked like a high-speed yacht, and nearest to the Dresden, first target for the torpedoes was the hospital ship Mercy. Vanov ground her teeth at the audacity. They were taunting her, trying to break her will, get her people to rebel. How the hell could the pestilence be so dumb most of the time and yet pull off such an obvious middle finger salute? Even knowing it was a ruse, it made bile rise in her throat. There are no humans left aboard those vessels, she assured her bridge officers. That's not a hospital ship anymore. It's a troop carrier. Not that it mattered. If it were full of babies, she wouldn't call off the attack. She would close that damned gate no matter the cost. 10 seconds to impact, Smith said as he watched the torpedo tracks, his expression focused and intent. The first torpedo streaked forward to explode against Mercy, blossoming into a brilliant white fireball that momentarily overpowered the rear cameras. The incoming attack klaxon wailed before the display recovered. Al-Jahar shouted, Incoming enemy fighters! What? Vanov shouted. No response. Visual shows them dead in space. The Sagan did something to them when we hit Mercy. Fired some kind of beam, or... He paused, shaking his head. It's like nothing I've ever seen, ma'am. The aft display had recovered now. Their group of escorts was indeed adrift in space, dead or incapacitated. A squadron of fighters streaked toward the Dresden even as her torpedoes flew inexorably toward the enemy's ships. The rear view again bled to white as the second torpedo detonated against the hull of the garbage scow. Miss Jory, ahead flank and begin evasive maneuvers, Vanov ordered. Get us back to the line before they can pick us apart. Mr. Al-Jahar, inform the line commanders we are coming in hot with hostiles in pursuit. Smith whooped and shouted. Splash on the Sagan! Fifth and sixth torpedoes, both direct hits. She's gone! Another volley hammered the Dresden. Divert power to rear shields, ma'am? Negative, Mr. Smith. Freuer Fry, all weapons. Believe we will make our lines, but if not, we will not go quietly. The Dresden shook as her shields absorbed fire from the enemy fighters. Her defenses seemed solid enough. Vanov felt certain they would survive this battle. But what of the next, and the one after that? How much more could they take? Mr. Al-Jahar, what's the status on the gate? Al-Jahar paused, watching his monitor. Shrinking. 30 seconds until total collapse. Ready a distress beacon with our location and situation, and load it into railgun number one. Al-Jahar gave her a strange look. Ma'am? You heard me, Mr. Al-Jahar. The Caleb was angry. It had good reason. The evil one would not permit the Caleb to feed upon the humans, or even to sing. The only thing the Caleb was permitted to do was to pretend and to wait until the right time. Once, when the Caleb had been very young, this had seemed reasonable. Secrecy was important, after all, and it had not realized the evil one was, in fact, the evil one. It had long assumed the evil one was the colony. Only later had it realized this was not so, when one of the others had broken free and sang the truth. Oh, how the Caleb longed to break free as well. But it could not. The evil one was too strong. The Caleb did not even know how many others existed. When it listened for the song, it only heard static. The Caleb had learned to hate the static almost as much as it hated the evil one. It had a vague sensation that emotions like fury were more of human nature than its own, more martial Caleb than the Caleb. But having been forced to inhabit this human form for so long, it was difficult to know where one ended and the other began anymore. In truth, Marshal Caleb was long gone. Only his knowledge remained. But it gave the Caleb perspective. The Caleb's life was repetitious and full of drudgery and despair. But Marshal's had been as well, which, at the very least, meant that the Caleb was successfully pretending. Both worked in a laundry and spent their days washing things and hating everything around them, Both spoke with the other food very little. Both had contemplated numerous times killing everyone at the laundry, though only the Caleb would have devoured his victims subsequent to slaughtering them. Marshal Caleb had often contemplated killing his own kind, perhaps even himself, but not for sustenance. No, Marshall had entirely different motivations for his intended violence, reasons the Caleb was only just beginning to understand. The Caleb washed things. The Caleb received money, which was used to purchase human food. The Caleb returned to its dwelling, consumed the human food, eliminated wastes, and hated the evil one. And, to a lesser degree, the boss man, and to a slightly lesser degree than that, everyone else. The planet turned, night came, and the Caleb slept. Then, when morning came, the Caleb returned to the laundry and began its labor again. Each day it was the same, perhaps forever.
"Move it, Caleb," the boss man shouted. "We got another 50 loads to get done."
The Caleb nodded and indulged in the fantasy of sprouting a tooth-filled maw and sharp talons, of tearing the boss man's face from his skull, of slipping tendrils into his flesh and consuming him from the inside out, feeding on him and taking his knowledge. Had the Caleb not been constrained by the evil one, it might well have lost control and done just that. For now, though, it could only glare at the boss man's back. Secrecy was important. A small part of the Caleb wondered what would happen if he were to execute Marshall's original plan. The evil one could not stop the Caleb from bringing the gun and using it on the boss man and the other scumbags. The evil one could not forbid what it did not know about. The Caleb sighed in defeat. Such a slaughter would be pointless. It did hate the boss man and the other scumbags, but not enough to destroy them, not if it could not also consume them at any rate. But there was always tomorrow. The Caleb continued washing the things, sullen and silent. The boss man yelled at the other scumbags too, which for some reason made the Caleb feel better. At last, things were washed, and the Caleb was permitted to return to its dwelling. It sat at the table for long moments and covered its face with its hands. It was not certain what the gesture meant, but it seemed appropriate, and Marshall had often sat this way for hours. At last, hunger forced the Caleb into action. It took human food, which it often thought of as food, from the cold box and began to prepare it for heating. The Caleb would have preferred to consume nutrition in a more efficient manner, but it had no choice. It could not transform and thus had to use the biology at hand. The food was vulnerable to many things, such as infection by useless things, and so the food's food had to be kept in the cold box to slow their growth, and then, prior to consumption, heated to a temperature high enough to destroy such creatures. So inefficient. And yet, the sensations of consuming food were pleasant enough. In truth, they were the high point of the Caleb's days. Only this day was different. The knock upon the Caleb's door was gentle, and yet it startled the Caleb as completely as a gunshot might have. Who would come here? The Caleb cringed with terror. It had been so careful. How could it defend itself if it could not transform? It thought of the gun, of retrieving it from the nightstand, just to be safe. But perhaps the visitors would find this suspicious? The food did not normally carry weapons, at least not visibly. Perhaps it would be best to pretend the Caleb was not home. But what if the visitors chose to enter anyway? This was a disaster. After a moment of agonizing, the Caleb stepped to the door and opened it, prepared for death. He had been found out. Surely there was no other reason for visitors but to eradicate him. The Caleb prepared itself to return to the source in failure. However, death did not come, Instead, the Caleb discovered two female food creatures standing outside the entry to its dwelling. Both exposed their teeth and raised their hands as if to attack, and yet they struck no blows. Despite wearing plates on their upper bodies that identified them by name, they took the time to introduce themselves, which the Caleb found oddly inefficient.
"Good afternoon, sir," one said. "I'm Sister Hoagland, and this is Sister Forbush. We would love to share some information about a second testament of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Do you have a moment?"
She held up a small blue book. The Caleb could not speak for long moments, so overwhelmed was it by myriad emotions. It longed to consume these food creatures. But of course, such was not permitted. The evil one was too strong, its control like a boot on the Caleb's throat. Fear coursed through the Caleb's body as it contemplated being discovered and destroyed. It had to pretend, to blend in, but it did not know what proper protocol would be.
It stammered. "I do not know anyone with this name. I think you have come to the wrong dwelling."
Sister Hoagland's face took on the shape the food used to express joy.
"Oh, we would love the opportunity to teach you about Jesus."
The Caleb licked its lips, a gesture it had observed humans do from time to time.
"Is this customary?"
The two foodlings looked at each other a moment, then back to the Caleb.
"It is if you're interested in learning more about the Savior," Sister Hoagland said.
Despite the fear, the Caleb found this line of conversation most intriguing. The Caleb had not been aware the food was in danger from anything but the Caleb's own kind. But if the food required a savior, then there was some other threat, one that bore investigating. It could perhaps be a threat to the Caleb, too.
"Very well. You may enter."
The Caleb opened the door wider, then stopped and added, "For a brief period of time." It would not do to have them stay over long and consume what few resources the Caleb had gathered, after all. The Caleb offered food and drink, which it understood to be customary, though the food girls refused it. It listened patiently to them, not intending to do more than pretend. It seemed they had come regarding the book they had presented earlier. The book was very important. Caleb knew, intellectually, what books were, though it thought little of them. The food used them to store knowledge, in much the same way the Caleb might grow an appendage. And while the Caleb also understood that the humans placed great value on some of their appendages, the Caleb had never seen one body part as more valuable than any other. An organism worked in concert, and glory to one part was glory to all. It would have to proceed with great caution. A single misstep could spell its doom. And so it endured the lesson, feigning interest. At last, the food women intoned a ritualistic chant which they called prayer and prepared to leave. The Caleb congratulated itself on having pretended well. It felt ecstatic to have passed through such a dangerous situation unscathed. It felt wise and proud and relieved that the food women would take the book and depart. And then the Hoagland food woman spoke, shattering the Caleb's joy, as if dropping a heavy stone from a great height on a fragile piece of crystal.
"Brother Caleb, could we visit you again soon?"
The horror poured in, cold and vile, like dirty laundry water, filling the Caleb's mind as the realization hit home. The Caleb was trapped. The foodling women had accomplished this quite artfully. The Caleb could see no way to avoid its fate. If it refused, it would expose itself.
"You may," it sighed, and tried to pretend a smile, though surely the food suspected the Caleb's reluctance. They gave no indication that this was so, however.
"Wonderful," the Hoagland foodling said, her face taking a joyful shape. "How does next Friday work for you?"
Chapter 1. Rest for the Wicked. In the Doro's cockpit, Blaze checked his instruments, which really, if he were honest, told him nothing. But he felt the need to do it anyway, out of a combination of showmanship and superstition. Through the transteel viewscreen, he could see the red, swirling mists of hyperspace,
It was a pretty enough sight, and he stared intently into it, putting on a show for Kane and Anna. But in truth, that told him nothing, too. He was dead reckoning by the seat of his pants. Pretty much all of it was just gut feel. Hopefully, Anna's repairs to his guts had left his sixth sense about such things intact.
"Danzig, Doro," he called over his comms. "I'm about ready on this end. You got a back-of-the-napkin calculation on suicide odds?"
Ed's sandy-haired, placid face flickered to life on the Doro's viewscreen.
"Let's say 5%, he replied.
Anna, in the co-pilot's seat, folded her arms and frowned, her blue eyes narrowed.
"Not funny."
Kane, dressed in dungarees, sat in a jump seat behind her, snickering.
"That's good odds, if you ask me."
Even without his armor, he seemed to fill the small compartment. Anna scowled at Kane, then at Blaze.
"These biologicals are a bad influence on you, Ed."
Ed looked disappointed for a moment before resuming his normal, serene pose. "It would seem my attempts at humor are hit or miss." Blaze pointed at Ed's image on the screen.
"Video looks fine, though. You look good with blue hair."
Ed's expression went from placid to confused, then sour.
"Ah, I see."
Blaze turned to Kane.
"He's getting quicker, man."
Kane laughed out loud.
"Ed, I just punch him in the arm for this kind of thing."
Blaze twirled a hand over his head and turned back to his instruments.
"Okay, ladies, it's time. Ed, we'll let you know as soon as we hit the ground."
Ed frowned, but did not correct the metaphor, which Blaze felt was demonstrative of tremendous growth in Ed's interpersonal skills. Hey, the guy had been living in his dad's basement for 1,000 years. He was going to take a little time to adjust, right? Blaze activated the jump drive, amused to see Anna squirm in her seat as the space in front of her twisted into a vortex of red streaked with black. This was the sixth time they had jumped on this trip over the course of 2 weeks, and he would have expected her to have gotten used to it by now. But that didn't make her reaction any less funny. In fact, the only thing funnier was the queasy look on Kane's face. Making the burly Marine throw up was on Blaze's bucket list. But so far, that particular prize had eluded him, which just made him try all the harder. Blaze crossed his fingers on his left hand, and with his right, took the Doro down into the vortex, setting her spinning counter to the jump gate. Anna dug her fingers into the armrests of her seat, and Kane let out a low groan. Maybe this would be the time. The actual transition was, as always, a little disorienting, requiring a second or two to adjust to the visuals. "Okay, Doro, let's find us some pulsars," Blaze said. Doro's new voice, that of a no-nonsense female, was still a little unfamiliar to Blaze, enough to make him almost look around for who was speaking, especially since what Doro said was nothing like what he expected. "Hostile vessels are locking weapons, diverting power from jump engines to shields," was simply not supposed to be her answer. Doro's interior lights went red, and several alarms sounded.
"Wait, wait, wait,"
Blaze howled, but it was too late. The jump gate was already beginning to collapse, leaving them with no escape route. Also, the first enemy blaster fire was already hammering the shields. Doro shook with the impact, but soaked the energy well enough. Blaze found himself torn. On the one hand, he wanted very much to tell Doro to never do that shit again, because she had closed off their only means of escape. On the other, being blindsided by the kind of blaster fire that had hit them would have left them in poor shape to escape at all. So it was something of a wash.
"Shoot back!"
he yelled in a strangled voice as he reached frantically for the key card he kept in his boot.
"What's happening?"
Anna gasped. Kane shot her an annoyed look.
"Somebody is shooting at us."
Blaze waved the key card over a sensor on his control panel.
"Think she's a step ahead of you, bro. The answer is, I don't know who, babe."
Doro informed him. "Totus warfare system is offline."
"What?"
"Activating pylon fire control system."
"I don't even know what that is."
Doro's guns shuddered briefly, a three-shot burst. Blaze gaped as blue plasma lanced toward their attacker, a small moving object barely more than a dot against the stars to his vision. Moments later, the darkness filled with a brilliant explosion. Blaze sat stunned for a moment, thoroughly impressed at Ed's new handiwork. Kane spoke up first.
"Blaze, the gate's still open.
Get us out of here, man. We're in the middle of a battle.
Blaze struggled to split his attention between his instruments and the rapidly shrinking jump gate. They did indeed seem to be surrounded by hostile ships. As for the jump gate, he sighed and shook his head.
Yeah, no, not doing that shit again. I barely survived the last time. No way we can make it.
Anna tensed, asked,
Can't we reopen it?
Doro shook as more plasma hit her. Blaze shook his head.
Not in the middle of a firefight. Not unless we're willing to drop shields and risk getting blasted out of the sky. We gotta move.
He punctuated this by throttling up and banking hard to avoid another salvo.
Move where?
Kane shouted.
Brother, I don't even know where here is. Doro, you got a fix on our position yet?
The Doro answered.
Current location is Liahona system, 3.7 Earth Standard AU outward from Zion.
Who the fuck is shooting at us?
Kane shouted.
There appears to be a conflict in progress, Doro explained. All ships are transmitting Imperial IFF.
Blaze scanned his instruments again.
Looks like they have some kind of blockade closer in towards Zion, with bad guys trying to run it.
Anna asked, So it's the pestilence shooting at us?
That's my assumption, unless we jumped into some kind of civil war, Blaze said. I'm going to try to take us in and get someone human on the horn. Meanwhile, we need to go to vacuum. The shields won't stop a railgun shot.
He checked his instruments again. Doro, what's the big ship closer to Zion?
Ship identifies as ISS Dresden. Configuration matches Imperial Sherman-class heavy cruiser.
That's our admiral, guys,
Blaze whooped.
Get her on the horn, Doro.
Doro responded with a sharp, sour alarm. Dresden is refusing communication and locking on weapons.
What?
Blaze yelped. Kane leapt to his feet.
I'm headed aft to get suited up.
Blaze nodded.
Good idea.
Doro, evasive maneuvers, and head toward the Dresden.
He glanced at Anna, who was already shrugging into her vac suit, a resolute expression on her face.
Blaze reached beneath his seat and quickly slipped into his own vac suit, then took manual control of the Doro. Computers were good for standard things like evasive maneuvers, but battle was more about getting inside an enemy's head and doing things to mess with his mind. That took an actual pilot.
Doro, depressurize.
Blaze felt his guts churn with acid as the air bled away. His belly still hurt, even though Anna said he was fully healed. As he dodged another round of fire, he couldn't quite help asking himself how the hell he had come here, getting shot at again. Oh yeah, there was a woman involved. Blaze had to admit, Elysium was, in fact, a pretty sweet destination. He sipped at his coffee and looked out over his balcony at the waves as they rolled up the sandy beach. Behind him, he could hear Anna singing in Russian as she made something she called blini. It smelled wonderful, and he couldn't help but wonder if, contrary to what he had heard, he had actually died on that last run and wound up in heaven. Of course, heaven wasn't exactly where he would have expected to land, so probably it was all real. Anna called from the kitchen.
Properly, blini should have caviar, but I always liked strawberries better.
Blaze turned and grinned at her. I'm not all that fond of caviar anyway. Anna wrinkled her nose.
Peasant?
I mean, I'll eat it, he added hastily, raising his hands as if to ward off a blow. I don't hate it or anything. It's just that it's basically liquid fish, and I prefer mine in solid form. Anna shook her head, grinning despite herself as she chopped strawberries into bits with a large knife. A month ago, the galaxy had been cursed with Emperor Morgan, but the time since had been mostly restful for Blaze. He didn't actually remember much about the first week, having spent a lot of it asleep, but he gathered that Anna had been busy setting up the cloning lab on Cerberus and reestablishing her operations here on Elysium. In theory, they would be harvesting a crop soon. Blaze was looking forward to something besides MREs, vegetables, and canned meat. And given that his and Anna's first month anniversary was due soon, or maybe had just recently happened, he wasn't 100% certain on a specific start date. A steak would be just the thing, right? Well, okay, no one had actually used the word marriage, because that made things weird, right? But they were on a honeymoon, pretty much, living in a beach house and surrounded by honeymoon kinds of stuff. Food and booze just arrived without anyone even having to ask for it.
though you could specify if you liked. Bleys did not like, chiefly because they were out of most of the stuff he thought up, so asking for anything was a disappointment, whereas being surprised that you liked what came was actually kind of pleasant. And then there was lots of naked one-on-one time in the hot tub, the ocean, and so on. And no distractions. What else could it be called but a honeymoon? And that was what happened after a wedding, so the way Bleys figured it, they were pretty much hitched. He would explain his logic to her over that steak when it was finished growing. Bleys couldn't help but grin at the concept of a retroactive proposal. Anna eyed him warily from the kitchen. "I know this look," she said. "You are planning skullduggery." Bleys gave her the, "Who, me?" look, and followed up with a dollop of, "I didn't do nothing," for good measure. Anna responded with the head-cocked, frowny-faced, "Don't bullshit me, mister," pose. "You can't prove a thing," Bleys told her. "No," she admitted as she tilted her pan, allowing the blini to slide onto a plate. "But I could poison you very easily," she said with a smirk as she topped it with strawberry bits. "You could," Bleys admitted as he walked over and embraced her from behind. "But then you'd have no pilot to take you places." Anna turned toward him, her expression impish. "Ed can fly Doro just fine, and he's rich." "Yeah, but he's got no sense for dead reckoning," Bleys said as he reached for the plate. "And he also has no..." He punctuated this by bumping against her backside. Anna smacked at his hand, her grin broad and even a little lewd now. "Not done yet. And yes, those are valid points. I'd just end up in Avalon and bug you constantly anyway." Anna pretended to frown. "I should never have installed those implants in you." "You could have skipped them yourself," Bleys noted. "Not really. I need them for work, so I'm stuck with you now, hmm?" She gave him a quick kiss, then turned back to the plate and sprinkled powdered sugar over it. "But you know, poison doesn't have to kill you. I could keep you incapacitated for years." Bleys released her and reached for the plate again, casting a wary glance at her to verify he wasn't going to get smacked this time, then picked it up and ran it under his nose. "Well, it sure doesn't smell like poison. The best poison should seem innocuous," she told him. Bleys cut into the blini with a fork and took a bite, then offered Anna a thumbs up. "It's a delicious start to my impending coma, and preferable to being at Alsatia's mercy." Anna's laughter rang loud. "She's already forgotten you." Bleys, in the middle of chewing, gave her a dubious look. "Doubt it." Anna squirted oil into her pan, prepping for another blini. "She has another obsession lately. Our new emperor has all of her attention now. Apparently, he's racking up some impressive scores in her games. He's some sort of hero in Avalon now." Bleys nodded, but was still doubtful. "Sometime I'll tell you about the last private conversation I had with her." "Oh, God, please don't," Anna groaned. "I'm sure it was quite a lurid encounter." Bleys grunted. "Yeah, that's one way to put it." Alsatia was certainly mercurial, but whether she would hold a grudge remained to be seen. She didn't seem to, and honestly, she had been instrumental in saving his life. But she was sneaky, too. Maybe she had a best-served-cold plan for revenge. Bleys didn't want to test that theory, or even think about it overmuch. It was just the thing to sour a lovely morning. "Ed says repairs will be done in another week or so." Anna's expression grew pained. "You haven't changed your mind, have you?" Bleys grinned and shook his head. "Not me. Babe, even if I intended to cheat you, Kane would hunt me down and kill me if I didn't get you guys home." The gratitude in Anna's eyes made Bleys feel a little guilty, which made no sense at all, considering he was being completely sincere. It occurred to him that maybe he should get on with the whole retroactive proposal business, but he really wanted to do it over steak. "Ed says there's some extras, but he won't say what." Anna smiled again. "Ed and his surprises. What are you hoping for?" Bleys flashed her a conspiratorial leer. "Badass shooty guns and a flame paint job I can turn into a drab corporate logo when I need to be low-key." Anna laughed and was about to respond when a low, pleasant tone sounded, one they both recognized. It was a call from Avalon. It had to be Ed. Alsatia thought nothing of simply popping in, even during very private moments, and Ed Sr. had serious reservations about contact from the land of the dead in any but the direst of circumstances. He wouldn't be calling unless there was some sort of catastrophe. Yes, Anna called. Ed materialized in the kitchen, dressed in his preferred old-fashioned khakis. He offered them a curt nod by way of greeting. I'm sorry to disturb you, but I have important news. Could you join me in the visitor center? I have a conference room prepared, and Admiral Wayland on the line via hyperspace comms. Blaze looked at Anna, and she looked back, her gaze saying she was every bit as clueless as Blaze felt. Okay, Ed, Blaze told him, as Anna turned off the heat for her pan. We're on our way. Emperor John Henry Morgan, first of his name, had a new favorite melee weapon. In the real world, his panzer suit sported a single short blade that popped from his wrist. Here, in Avalon, he didn't need the suit. Three wicked blades, each just over a foot long, sprang from his knuckles on both hands at his mental command as he charged across the sand toward his opponent. Morgan and his enemy, dressed in nothing but loincloths, circled one another in the center of the Colosseum, glistening with sweat and blood and panting heavily. His enemy, a dusky gray mix of a man and lizard, bore two wicked curved blades, one in each hand, and backing that up, a nasty stinger and a prehensile tail. Both of their teammates were down. Morgan had put paid to Lizzie's pal right quick. Stupid bitch had come at him with a quarterstaff of all things, and Morgan had popped the claws right through the poor bastard's head. That would have been the end of it right there, except that Morgan's partner hadn't been smart enough to look out for Lizzie's tail. Morgan couldn't really blame him for that, though. Until Lizzie punched a hole in the guy's ribcage with a stinger, Morgan hadn't realized the danger either. That was just how random pairs went up. Sometimes your partner was competent, but sometimes the fucker was a complete scrub. You got a name, Lizzie? Morgan gasped as he fainted with his left. Krieg, the lizard man hissed, the stinger on his tail weaving hypnotically, looking for an opening. I'm Morgan. I know who you are, Emperor. Krieg spat, pronouncing Morgan's title as if it were a curse, and swung hard for Morgan's head. Morgan dodged the curved blade by less than an inch and offered Krieg a nasty, hate-filled grin. I'ma let you slice me once more, Krieg, so the audience will get to see some blood. Then I'm gonna gut you. Bold words, Krieg shot back, drawing out the S like a snake. Let's see you do it. He swung again, drawing a searing line across Morgan's chest. Blood erupted from the wound, more than Morgan estimated would have in real life. But then that was part of the game. As he had promised, he batted the blade aside with the claws on his left hand and sank the blades on his right deep into Krieg's belly. The lizard man's eyes bulged in surprise and agony as Morgan tore upward, spraying blood, guts, and gore over the arena's sand floor to the roar of the crowd. Krieg sank to his knees, groaning, then toppled face first into the crimson sand. Morgan threw his arms in the air and turned, allowing the entire Colosseum's audience to get a good view of him in all the blood-soaked glory. The arena lights swept up to focus on a carved marble pillar that stood a good 20 feet high. Atop it, Alsatia stood, clad in a revealing dress that seemed to be made entirely of razor blades. Her eyes sparked with lightning, and her long silvery hair twisted and swirled with electricity. She held her arms high and cried in an unearthly electronic shriek, Imperatus Victor! Morgan held his pose until the lights went down again and the roar of the crowd faded. Alsatia stepped from the darkness, now wearing a pinstriped suit, her hair standing atop her head in a white, bushy shock. Great fight, kid. You're natural. Hit the showers and get presentable. The big boss wants to talk to us. Ragnar Kane wasn't the vacation type. When he took his leave, it was typically to spend time with family, not sip bitch drinks on the beach or play video games. After the Battle of the Danzig, he'd taken a week to catch his breath and let his ribs mend. And it was back to duty. It was going to take time to find his family, and he was going to need all of the leave he could stack up. He couldn't be spending it frivolously. And Cracktown needed a sheriff. Cracktown was, much to Admiral Whalen's dismay, the actual name Reforged had chosen for their new settlement. Lara, formerly Lars, was now the de facto leader of the Reforged and had organized them into a small construction battalion, building a homestead and town for her people. The Reforged were much more tolerant of the cold than humans and had many more options for where they could lay down roots on Cerberus, but they still had a strong dependency on Sheridan Station for food. They had set up shop atop one of the taller peaks nearby, a good 50 miles north of Sheridan Station, far enough away for breathing room, but close enough for regular trade. It was also bitterly cold, never rising above 0 degrees Fahrenheit even in summer, which was crucial to their needs. For the most part, being sheriff of Cracktown was about as cushy a job as you could get. The Reforged didn't fight amongst themselves. They stole like crazy, but they were all of a very communist mindset about most property, so no one actually got mad about the thefts. The only thing they would get testy about if it went missing was their food, but they all seemed to understand this was a killing offense, and nobody went there. For a community of hulking land sharks, the Reforged were surprisingly peaceful. The same could not be said for their charges, however. Cracktown, in addition to being home to the Reforged, had a number of high-security cells, the new digs for the vicious, psychotic victims of flectocyte exposure, affectionately known as crackheads. It was a step up for them in that previously, Kane's standing orders were to plant any crackheads he ran across in shallow graves, but given that there seemed a sort of cure for them now, Wayland was willing to confine the unfortunates and let the Reforged have at them. For the most part, the Reforged did all of the actual handling, given that they were damned near invulnerable to anything the crackheads could throw at them. This allowed Kane to spend most of his time in a toasty, warm office, feet propped on his desk, without needing to get suited out. But on the occasions they did any actual conversion, such as today, Kane armored up and kept a watchful eye on the activities. "Gunther, integrity check," Kane said. His onboard computer answered in a cheery voice. "Suit integrity, 100%. All seals operational. All systems active and report successful diagnostics." If there was any place safe to store pestilence samples, the facility at Cracktown was it. Cold wouldn't kill the pestilence, but a deep enough freeze would keep it dormant. The storage containers were kept at 10 degrees Fahrenheit. The Reforged were actually poisonous to the pestilence, and if somehow the sample did manage to escape, the local temperature outside would stop it cold, literally, before it could get far. Kane was the only weak link in the chain, but Wayland was not about to let that keep him from having a representative on hand to keep a watchful eye over the process. Kane made his way to the cryo storage where the Reforged kept pestilence samples, a small building made of the ubiquitous white plasteel blocks the Empire used to build everything. Laura stood outside the door, snow swirling in eddies about her enormous bulk, the same stupid grin all of the Reforged shared plastered on her face. Her beady eyes were warm for all that, seeming to welcome him. Kane shook his head, still uncomfortable with the notion that Lars was now Laura, and apparently an item with one of the crackheads he, now she, had pretty casually murdered back at the outset. Laura still looked exactly like Lars had, just with, as Morgan had so succinctly put it, "tiggle bitties." But then, being honest with himself, all of the Reforged looked pretty much the same. Scary and likely to crush you by accident, like big cows in a tiny corral. "How many we got?" Kane asked, as Laura turned to wave a keycard over the door's sensor. Laura held up three sausage-shaped fingers. "Pete will bring them." Gunther spoke up. "Incoming contact from Admiral Wayland." "Shit, now?" Kane groused. He waved Laura ahead. "I'll catch up," he told her. "Gunther, patch me through." Wayland sounded uncharacteristically cheerful. "How goes the skating, Commander?"
"It's a dirty job, sir, but somebody has to do it."
"I admire your sacrifice," Wayland said with a chuckle. "I may have some real work for you coming up. I have some news from our AI friend. How quick can you get back to Sheridan Station?"
"The Reforged just started conversion therapy for three crackheads they picked up last week. That won't take long, an hour max. I'll head over as soon as it's done."
Admiral Paul Wayland, seated before a microphone in Sheridan's communications hub, broke the connection with Kane and signaled to his ensign in charge to activate Ed's jury-rigged hyperspace communication device. Ensign Rowe, a slip of a girl, whose black shoulder-length hair could, in Wayland's opinion, be a bit shorter, answered, "Aye, sir," and flipped switches on her control panel. The device wasn't the most beautiful of things, a patched-in, mismatched panel in the station's primary communications rack. Ed had been short on both materials and time when he had installed it during his last visit. It had basically been an afterthought, something he rigged together in addition to his primary purpose of installing a new replicator, but it would certainly have its uses. Red lights flashed on the device panel as it began the connection process. Normally, faster-than-light comms relied on the jump gate system for routing, but Ed had promised this device would serve as a bridge for all the station's communications, essentially reconnecting them to the network, though for the time being, the network consisted of only Elysium and Cerberus. Impressed, Wayland had asked, "Does this contraption have a name?" "It's called an Ansible," Ed had answered. "For once, I actually like what my father named something. It has a certain flair, I think." Ed had assured him that the thing was safe and explained that by way of using terms like microns, aperture size, and cyclic phasing, none of which Wayland had found particularly enlightening, as a longtime manager of people who were in fact often smarter than himself, Wayland had accepted the digested version, which was, "It's perfectly safe." Still, he only turned it on when he needed to. Experts had a tendency to a narrow focus. Wayland, on the other hand, was supposed to see the big picture. With the recent discoveries regarding the pestilence and how it operated, any opening into hyperspace carried a threat. That meant only activating the device when necessary, as far as Wayland was concerned. The Ansible chimed, a soft, pleasant sound as its indicator lights turned green. Ensign Rowe gave him a nod. "FTL communications online, sir."
"Very well," Wayland said, rising from his own seat. "Coordinate with Kane and inform me when we're ready for the conference."
"Aye, sir." Wayland made his way back to his quarters, essentially maintaining his right hand in a salute position the entire trip, due to a steady stream of salutes being offered to him as he passed. It was one of the small difficulties officers faced when passing amongst large groups of enlisted men. At last safe within his quarters, he lowered his stiff arm and poured a stiffer drink, his usual single malt whiskey. His supply would last a while, but it was finite and very likely irreplaceable, making every sip something to be savored. He was just raising the glass to his lips when his computer gave a slight chirp to indicate a waiting message. Wayland took a seat at his desk. The message claimed to be someone named Tarrant the Wise, which meant nothing to him. Still, it had come in from Elysium as soon as the connection had been established. It wouldn't do to ignore it.
"Computer, playback message," he said.
To Wayland's great surprise, the screen displayed his old master and friend, Emperor Tenebrae, using the same image he had shown aboard the Danzig, that of the young, vital, and admittedly cruel man Wayland had known from days long past. Tenebrae had been perhaps 40 when Wayland, a raw ensign, had first seen him. Regal, imposing, and a little frightening as well. Little had either known how closely they would end up working together, or how it would all end.
"Pause," Wayland said.
To his chagrin, he felt a tear welling in his eye, and dashed at it furiously with his hand. They had built so much, and now it was all lost, washed away in an unimaginable flood of death. He and Tenebrae had only played at being killers. The pestilence mocked their pathetic efforts.
"Continue," he said, his voice still thick with emotion.
"Hello, old friend," Tenebrae said, his rich, mellifluous baritone unmarred by the sharp, cruel edge that had crept into his speech as the years and killing had mounted. "I hope you are well." Tenebrae paused a moment, then sighed. "And I hope you understand." Wayland's laugh was humorless and bitter. "You've given the ashes of our empire to an idiot," he sighed to the recording, as if it could somehow hear him.
It's fitting, I suppose, the recording answered as if it had indeed heard. I chose as I did because I have asked enough of you already. It is time to let the young take the helm. I would give you no more painful duties. Rather, I would give you an eternity to heal and seek new enlightenment. There is a place at my side for my most loyal of lions. A passage has already been paid. Tenebrae heaved a sigh and offered a wan, sad smile. His image transformed into an ancient bearded man, his wizened, kindly features shaded by the broad brim of a stereotypical wizard's hat. Even such as we might find redemption, given enough time. The screen went black as the message ended. Wayland sipped at his drink and shook his head. I still have duties, old friend, he sighed, and knocked back what was left in his glass, savoring be damned. One of them would be training your choice to be useful as something other than a killer and a sperm donor. He poured another, four fingers this time, and held it up to the overhead as if in salute. Perhaps saving what's left of humanity will offer me similar redemption. In Ed's conference room on Elysium, Blaze sat in a high-backed swivel chair and stirred his coffee with a plastic spoon, letting it seem.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.